हेलो, आ गया ना ये टाइम। हाय हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग, वेलकम टू टुडेस पैनल। टुडे वी आर गोना टॉक अबाउट सस्टेनेबल ग्रासलैंड्स एंड सस्टेनेबल लाइवस्टॉक मैनेजमेंट। सो आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम एवरीबॉडी हियर टुडे। माय नेम इज जोसेफिना एसेल। आई वर्क फॉर द ग्लोबल राउंड टेबल फॉर सस्टेनेबल बीफ। फॉर दोस दैट हैवंट हर्ड अबाउट GRSB, the Global Roundtable. We are a multi-stakeholder initiative. We are global. We have representatives from the beef sector, from all different constituencies, from producers, processors, input providers, civil society, and also we collaborate with academia and research. So we are here today to talk about grasslands, sustainable livestock. So before starting the panel, I would like to introduce to Lloyd Day. He's from ICA. He's the deputy director of ICA. And so Lloyd, please.
Thank you, Josefina, and welcome everyone. For those of you who haven't been here yet, like Theo, this is the House of Sustainable Agriculture of the Americas, but we have a lot in common with the whole world. And I know not all of you are from the Americas. You're from South Africa, beautiful country. We've been talking here for the last 2 weeks about the importance of agriculture as part of the solution to climate change. Sometimes, and we had a great panel yesterday with you guys where we had a farmer from Brazil who, you know, just said that he feels like he's the villain, but because people don't understand how he is taking care of the land and his family's taking care of the land. And so I think there's a great deal of ignorance about the importance of animal agriculture, the importance of grasslands and livestock for the management of those grasslands and taking care of the environment, taking care of our soils, taking care of our water and the health, preventing fires, etc. And so I look forward to listening to your presentation today. You're all very welcome here. This is your home, and good luck on the panel. Thank you, Josefina.
Thank you, Lloyd. Thank you for the introduction. Okay, so I'm going to start just introducing the panel. So the idea is, as Lloyd said, to learn more about grasslands for those that, or also to hear about the voice from the farmers, from the civil society, about the work that they do on grasslands. Many of the organizations that we work with, they really have farms where they have grasslands in the farm. So they are really, many of the grasslands is on private land. So they are really kind of the one that are taking care of that. And they're providing a very important environmental service. So today we're going to talk about that, about the different practices, how livestock grazing grasslands can really be done sustainably and the importance to do it sustainably to be sure that you retain water, that you store carbon, and also the importance of having high productivity on the grasslands and efficiency also to grow animals better and more sustainably, more efficiently. So ideally also we would like to raise awareness on all these kind of people about the importance of grasslands and livestock and how this like a cycle that with our rotational grazing and with good practices, how we can really contribute to climate change mitigation. So I have just some facts about the grasslands that I think before introducing the panel, I would like just to present. So about grasslands, they represent 30% of the Earth's surface. So this 30%, it's a lot of the Earth's surface. 5% of the world population live in natural grasslands and depends on the environmental service of these. The ecosystem provides 70% of the this ecosystem provides 75% of the forage for domestic animals. So it's a huge feed for the animals. It's very important like how the animals that really graze here, that they eat from these grasslands. They are habitat for wildlife, for birds, and for all different types of wildlife, and they are capable to absorb 30% of the CO2 that is produced. So I think they really have a very important ecosystem service. So I'm going to start introducing the first panelist. So we have Theo De Jager. He's a farmer from South Africa. So I will let Theo introduce himself, and he's coming from South Africa. So I think it's important for us to know more about how is the grasslands and the livestock management in South Africa, and how is the conservation of the grasslands in your region. So welcome to the panel.
Thank you very much. What a privilege to be part of this discussion. I'm In South Africa, I farm with subtropical fruits, avocados and macadamias. But I am also farming with partners on livestock in Zambia, Mozambique, and Congo Brazzaville. South Africa is somehow a microcosm of the rest of our continent because it has the same composition, more or less one third desert, semi-desert, dry areas, more or less one third grasslands and savannas, and more or less one third forests, subtropical area, and arable farming. Now, the problems with grasslands is that we cannot eat grass. There's only one way to utilize the 30% of grasslands in our country, on our continent, and in the world for food security, and that is by farming livestock there. This is my 12th COP. I remember when we were only two farmers at a COP and we were excited about being there. I remember the excitement when the two grew to four in 2012. This year, we've had close to 150 farmers at this COP. I remember the struggles to have agriculture and our food systems included in a global agreement to follow the Kyoto Protocol, because in there was nothing about food and agriculture. But we did not see the pressure coming, not on agriculture as a whole, and definitely not on the livestock system. And when it came, and it happened more or less at Katowice, as farmers, we realized that we dare not shy away from the most difficult questions. If we don't have proper answers, we are indebted to the global society. And we also realized in the first discussions amongst each other that we are not all the same. No two farmers farm the same. What to say, farmers on different continents? And the answers to the difficult questions being asked around here will also not be the same. Solutions will not be the same. Solutions which are applicable in South Africa will not be the same as those in Congo. Those from Africa will not be the same as those in Oceania. There are no one-size-fits-all solutions. Hence, thank you for the opportunity to speak from my experience from Southern Africa. I think there are four things which are very important to be part of any answer when the pressure comes on to livestock and agriculture. And the first is that farming is not only about the production of food. And what we produce as livestock farmers is not only about nutrients. Farming is also a deeply cultural aspect of societies. Food is not only about nutrition. Maybe one day the world will try to feed its growing population with a few energy bars every day and a few tablets. But will you invite your families and friends to dinner to have a few tablets and an energy bar? Food also has a societal value and a cultural value. And in many of the world's biggest religions, it has a religious value. In the area where I come from, in Africa, livestock is the bank for the unbankable. It's the piggy bank. That's what you sell if there's a funeral that needs to be paid in this week. That's what you sell if you urgently need to pay medical fees or school fees. And livestock is also a way of identifying oneself. There's a very good reason why the Nguni breed of cattle is found in the eastern parts of our continent, the Tulis, in the drier savanna areas of Botswana, Zimbabwe. The people who farm it, they see it as part of their identity. But if it comes to food, I'm chairing the board of Funderpan, which is a policy analysis network in the space of food, agriculture, and natural resources. It's an NGO that belongs to governments in Africa. And one of our biggest projects so far was to try to get more nutrition, more proteins to pregnant women and babies up to the age of two. You see, if you miss the proteins in that phase, you never catch up again. This is the source of stunting. We call it the Otunu project, but I forgot what Otunu stood for, Tembi. And in this program, we discovered that there are cultural barriers to access to proteins. One actually needed to reprogram some cultural beliefs to get the proteins to pregnant women in deep rural areas. And those are the most vulnerable communities. Those are the poorest. And those are the ones who do not ask questions about nature-friendly farming. Nothing stops hungry people. Definitely not regulations about nature-friendly. They want to get to food. So for me, coming from South Africa, when I first went into Angola and Congo Brazzaville and Cameroon, getting into deep rural villages and seeing the struggle for food on a daily basis in households, I realized that there is no bigger driver of climate change in Africa, in the poorer parts of Africa, than poverty and hunger. That drives deforestation. That causes the biggest single threat to our grasslands, and that's fire. A third of our continent burns down every year in search of bushmeat. And that puts the worst kind of black carbon back into the atmosphere. That's the reason why areas which have never been farmed has poor soils. No biological material ever had the opportunity to go into the soil because it burns down every year. So what is the solution? The first solution is better communication to the communities on the grasslands and from the communities on the grasslands. Now, this was not possible 6 or 7 years ago. Today, it is possible. Because today, you can go into these deep rural areas and every family would have a mobile phone. It is possible to get the message to them and to receive a message from them. Today, it is possible because we sit with a generation who are not yet 30 and which is in the vast majority on our continent. And that is the part of the population that will grow by probably another billion in the next 20 years. We have a different understanding of the challenges than my generation has. And it is important because that generation also today makes the links with other generations from which they were isolated until very recently. And in this communication, the three most important messages is that you don't need to go to the urban areas. You don't need to live in a city to have a proper livelihood. You can actually have a proper livelihood there where you come from if you have a heart for the rural spaces. Secondly, you must live in harmony with your environment. And to live in harmony, you must do something special. It does not come by itself. Agriculture has never been in harmony with nature. Never, because nature seeks balances. If there's too much of the one, there will be something on the opposite side. So to provide surpluses, we as farmers need to take out competition. This is why we do weeding on our fields. This is why we are doing predation in our livestock. And if you disturb the harmony, you have to do something special to restore it on those areas where you do not need intensive production. And then thirdly, we must somehow make sure that we produce enough of that in which we have a competitive advantage so that we can exchange from the food basket those nutrients in which we do not have a competitive advantage. Food security will never again mean that any country, any area, produce everything it consumes. Trade becomes the most important aspect in global and continental food security. And to access trade, we need that kind of communication. Thank you.
Thank you, Theo. Thank you very much. I think it's very important also to raise all the also importance on this social aspect that you brought here today about also food security and the cultural barriers also to consume beef and nutrition. So I think that's important also to talk about that today. And I also like that today, I don't know if you know, but today is the solution day at COP. So it's a day, but really the COP, they just titled about solutions. So I think it's very important that we later will also will talk about that. What solutions do we expect to come out from this COP, and especially related to grasslands, to livestock. So thank you also for bringing that idea of looking for solutions. Okay, so thank you. I'm gonna now pass to Hilary Fenrich. Hilary Fenrich is from National Wildlife Federation. She represents the civil society. So I'm gonna let Hilary introduce herself. And also Hilary, if you can talk us about what role has the civil society on grasslands, what role has your organization does on that, and if you can tell us about the meat packers and the supply chain, how what also role they have here to play.
Thank you, Josefina. Good morning, everyone. Thanks, Josefina, for the opportunity. Thank you, Lloyd, for the pavilion space. It's a fantastic dialogue. Theo, you're a hard man to follow. I am not a producer, but I do want to just talk a little bit about civil society initiatives, what we are working on at National Wildlife Federation today. So as Josefina mentioned, I'm our manager of our international team, National Wildlife Federation. We're based in the United States. We have the fantastic Edie Juno in the back, who is our expert on domestic agriculture. But today I'll talk a little bit about Brazil and Paraguay more than anything. Josefina and the Global Roundtable for Sustainable Beef and I have been working on the Nature Positive Working Group and our decade-long goal. The GRSB recently released 3 different goals, and one of those was on Nature Positive, which was really about land use change and sustainable livestock management practices. Today, I want to bring a little bit of context from Brazil, particularly around the Cerrado. So the Cerrado is the world's most biodiverse savanna, and it has vast ecosystem services. It has 8 of the 12 river basins in Brazil, so it's highly important both in terms of livestock management, but also ecosystem services that the world needs. And also from the Gran Chaco. So there was just a presentation yesterday on the Gran Chaco here at ICA. And for those of you that don't know, the Gran Chaco covers both Brazil, Paraguay, Argentina, and Bolivia as well. We see a lot of water practices in the Gran Chaco, and that's particularly because there needs to be excellent water management practices. So in Paraguay, for instance, they have Tajamares, and they also have Australian tanks, so taking from all of the expertise in Australia. And they also have the largest South American bird running around, so the Rey Americano, which is amazing. If you all haven't seen it, highly recommend. The National Wildlife Federation, we work directly with the private sector. And the reason why is when we're thinking about grasslands and we're thinking in general about livestock management, we recognize that the pinch point is really working with meat packers and working with cooperatives. When you're thinking about a beef supply chain and you're thinking about 7-8 billion consumers and millions of producers, it's a lot to handle. I think all of us could work all our lives on that, and we still wouldn't necessarily be able to make the impact that we want to see unless we work with that pinch point and have that real theory of change. And so there's actually only about 25 meat packers in the Cerrado and the Gran Chaco and the Amazon that represent more than 50% of the market share. So if you work with those meat packers and those cooperatives, you can really help move them towards asking for sustainable land management practices to their producer, and that kind of moves the needle. So the National Wildlife Federation, we work on commitments, we work on guidance, we work on traceability, verification, and reporting. And we also really help to find solutions, which is perfect for the Solutions Day. Another piece of what we do is try to bring international demand signals from pending legislation to these meatpackers so they can help access the markets that they currently have and keep their access there, but also grow their access elsewhere. And then we also educate up and down the supply chain. So what we see from banks sometimes is banks don't know what to ask meatpackers. They don't know how to connect with their supply chains or their funding partners. And then we also see from retailers want to connect to producers, but they don't know how. And so we help kind of bridge that connection. And there's essentially three major pieces of what I want to bring today, which was, first of all, public commitments, guidance for more responsible sourcing. What does that look like? In the Cerrado, so the world's largest, most biodiverse savanna, Chico, I would be remiss not to mention Chico, who's our expert and lives in the Cerrado. Please talk with him afterwards. There is a voluntary industry-aligned protocol. This is really to help support what does responsible sourcing look like in the Cerrado. And we've been working behind the scenes with the industry to pull everyone together to make sure that we're all moving towards an aligned goal. So this is fully aligned with the official data sources in the Cerrado. It talks about conversion, productivity, make sure that we're respecting indigenous lands, Kiambola lands, protected area, embargoed areas, as well as slave labor. And there was a pilot recently conducted with the major meat packers in the Cerrado, who source from the Cerrado, to make sure that this would be reasonable. So if folks in this room are sourcing from the Cerrado or thinking about what is possible to ask stakeholders in the Cerrado, that's a great first step to really understand where we should all be moving towards. We know that the ecosystem services in grasslands are not only everything that we know about carbon sequestration, but also provisioning services, biodiversity, connectivity. The producers can probably speak more about that as they're experts in the field. But it's also a home for indigenous peoples. So the Chaco, for instance, the Gran Chaco is home to 27 different tribal nations. And what we see is sustainable production can really mean resilience and also a sustainable livelihoods for people. So first off, we help stakeholders set public commitments to promote more responsible sourcing. Then we also work with folks on alignment for data. So this is everything from indirect supplier traceability in Brazil and the Cerrado to our collaboration in Paraguay with the government, which is really helping point out if producers are missing some important documentation. We say, hey, there's no problem. Let's help you align. Let's help you regulate. And this supports better movement towards responsible sourcing. And that's just the next step for carbon sequestration data. You can kind of layer that in as well, as we know that the Cerrado is kind of the next step there. And then finally, we think it's really important to support producer recognition in order to find the solutions. So that's everything from meatpackers and civil society can help really support in terms of technical and legal assistance. So that's regularization of documents if folks are out of compliance. We know that soil is one of our most precious resources, and we know that producers are tenders of the soil. We know that they can help control erosion, degradation, desertification. They're currently facing challenges in terms of drought and unpredictable rainfall. And so what we can see, there goes my notes. What we can see, thank you, is those producers can help bring forward sustainable management practices, whether that's crop rotation, rotational grazing, whether that's nitrogen fixing plants, which are really like a win-win for both wallet and the environment. We know that in Brazil, as well in Paraguay, that legal forest reserve is necessary in grasslands. So in the Cerrado, you have a minimum of 20% legal reserve that you can't touch that land. And in Paraguay, you have up to 45% where you can't touch the land. It's only forest or it's only native grasslands. We also know that there's silver pastoral systems, so trees and grazing integrated. And we also know that there can be mechanisms such as earlier termination, which not only cuts methane emissions, but also resources that are needed. So I think bringing those three pieces together is kind of the role that civil society can play, helping set out what does a good commitment look like? What are the sustainable management practices? What is the data that is necessary, helping bridge that data? And then how do we recognize producers? Because at the end of the day, they're integral to everything that we're working on. Thank you, Josefina.
Thank you, Hillary. Thank you very much. I think it's very important also to see that the private sector, the civil society, not only the producers, they have a role to play in the grasslands conservation. So it's very important to see that the private sector is committed, not only because there are requirements from the market, because that they also understand the importance of the grasslands. So to have even more private sector collaboration here at this COP, we saw a lot of private sector also participations in different pavilions, but I think it's very important to work together and not to have like independent silos working on this conservation. So I think that's very important. And we are going to talk about later, maybe a little more about legislations. I think it's very important, all the different policies and how are these kind of local legislations that Hillary mentioned, that mainly they are focused on forests, not so much on grasslands. And I think it's also very important to have that into the sphere to start thinking about how to, yeah, to set policies and frameworks to really put the importance of the grasslands conservation in that. And finally, data that also is very important that we are going to address, like not only on carbon, on water, and on all the biodiversity services that the grasslands have. And it's important to have those numbers to understand them and also to be able to communicate to the world, and to that will help also to raise awareness. So thank you, Hillary. So now we are going back to another farmer, this time from Argentina, my home country. So I would like to give the welcome to Christian Felcam. He's from CREA, a lead producer association. He will explain more about the great work that CREA does in Argentina together with many other farmer associations. And yeah, so Christian, just tell us about the grasslands in Argentina, the work that CREA does, and also talk about livestock. What's the role in livestock?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Josefina. Thank you, GRSB, for the opportunity to share some thoughts from CREA regarding this, and thank you, Lloyd, for this wonderful space that we really took advantage during these days. Was extremely positive. CREA is a farmer organization which is formed, directed, and financed by farmers. We have already 60 years in Argentina, and basically the idea is that the farmers learn from each other. Peer-to-peer is the best way to learn from each other to enhance the adoption of technologies. So we have 2,000 members, 2,100 members now in Argentina, covering the whole country. And basically the idea of sharing knowledge, sharing information, sharing challenges, is that how to be more sustainable at the farmer level, how we can be positive with our communities, where are we living from. Theo mentioned a lot the social importance of farming, and we are convinced of that. We believe on climate change. I think it is very important because sometimes we felt so attacked in the agricultural sector, in the farming sector, from some voices, that it is important to say that we are convinced in CREA, in our agricultural sector, that climate change is the biggest challenge of humanity in terms of impact and complexity. And to say, I mean, I'm a beef producer as well, and I know what complexity is, but this complexity is of a level that it's really, I think there is no previous situation of humankind to have this level of complexity. And we talk about complexity, it's very important that in our narrative, we must explain that there are no quick fix. There are no quick fix. Because you can go around and you listen, okay, we have to change our diet and then we will solve the problem. We have to turn into organic, and then we solve the problem. We are not going to solve the problem with just one solution. It is not possible. It is not easy to say. On Sunday, we traveled to El Cairo, and in this flight, we emitted so much CO2 as one people consuming beef during the whole year. So just and we do not say, I'm convinced that we do not have to say, do not fly anymore to El Cairo. Just to El Cairo, 370 kilometers away. We believe in climate change, and in Argentina, we recognize, we acknowledge that our sector, AFOLU, agriculture, forestry, and land use change, has a huge impact. In Argentina, it's 39%, and the beef sector, the livestock sector, but beef is the most important in Argentina, is 20% of our inventory of greenhouse gases is from the beef sector. So we are really part of the problem, but also we are really part of the solution. It is not without ranchers, it's not without beef producers that we can solve the problem. We have about a little bit more of 50 million cattle in Argentina, spread in about 150 million hectares. 85% is native grasslands, rangelands, with 200 millimeters till 2000 millimeters in the north. Completely different situations, but the same. If there is something common, is that the cultural aspect that Theo emphasized very much is very related to our nationality, to be Argentine. 93-95% of the dry matter that all the cattle in Argentina consumes is grassland. In some way, some pastures, mainly native grasslands. And you have about 7%, 5% of grains, maize basically, and some of silage. You have these finishing systems that you mentioned that improve the stability of the systems, because we know that grasslands depend very much on rain, and 99% of our grasslands are rain fed. So we have this year, the third year consecutive of La Niña, and we have really a drought situation, which is very complicated. So in those moments, it's very important to have these modules of grain feeding stations in order to improve stability, to kind of buffer the production, and also to reduce the greenhouse gases. Mm-hmm. 75% of the greenhouse gases in the beef sector in Argentina, if you make the footprint from the production till the packer, 75% is depending on the cow-calf operations, the breeding, the production of cows. And this is a situation that is worldwide. All around this, the problem is the problem are the cows that they are producing. And also the solution are the cows, because they are breaking out the cellulose and producing high quality food from grasslands, which otherwise they don't have another use. This 130 million hectares that we use with cattle, if we take out the cattle, it's not possible to use it in other way. I mean, in terms of production, you can see as a landscape, but it could be really a problem from the point of view of fires. And we are seeing these aspects of fire, or these problems of fires, national parks and different location in Argentina where the cattle was took out. 75% of is in cow calf operations, sorry, and the adoption of technology is extremely important. We have estimations on the footprint, and we have seen that the average footprint in terms of CO2, kg of CO2 equivalent per kilograms of beef, it's about a carcass, it's about 24% in Argentina, 24 kilos in Argentina, 24, 25, depending on the year. But you have really a range. The worst farmers, they have about 40 kilograms. And this is very important because the average that you see at worldwide is 60 kilograms. And we have 40 kilograms in the bottom quartile. But the top quartile is 18 kilograms. So there's a lot of space to improve our footprint, to reduce the footprint. It is possible to produce the same quality, the same amount of beef with the half of the impact, let's say. And we make a paper on together with WWF in Argentina, which is Fundación Vida Silvestre. And we realized that it is possible to cut the emissions of the beef sector in 15% with simple measurements. But it's not that easy. Of course, it's not that easy. We have also this situation of that the cows are the bank of the unbankable, like you mentioned, Theo, in South Africa and Africa. And there are several situations of where the adoption of technology is not so fast as it could be. In general, we can say that the lowest footprint is in those farmers which are more professional, and the highest footprint, you have it in the small farmers. So that poses us another challenge as well. We know that in the agricultural sector, we have three main musts for the next decades. We have to reduce this footprint, the carbon footprint of all our agricultural production. We have to replace this ancient photosynthesis by new photosynthesis. Biofuels is a part of the solution we believe in of climate change. And also we have to be carbon positive, not only to sequester the carbon of our production that we meet in our production, but also to be carbon positive, because it is highly probable that many sectors will not be they will not be carbon positive or carbon neutral. So in our sector, it is expected that we sequester all this carbon. And the reality, the reality in our region is that we do not know yet how to be carbon positive. We have examples. We have situation where we know and we have data that we are carbon positive, but we have to study a lot more. We have to detect which are the systems which are promising in terms of carbon neutrality or to be carbon positive. We have to work a lot. And it's very important that it is not possible to import solutions as in another industries where you can import solar panels from one place to the other, the same. But the farming situation is completely different within the country and between countries. So the adoption and the technologies that could resolve the problem are completely different. So we can be inspired by what others does, but we need to develop our own solution. So research, development, and innovation, extremely important in the next years. The second, of course, communication. We mentioned that it is extremely important to be here in the COP, that ICA is here in the COP. It's to work together with civil society and academia is extremely important to improve our communication with the society as a whole and the policymakers. And finally, we believe that we can make a difference as CREA there. Once we have these solutions, it's extremely important to improve the adoption of these technologies. We can have it available, but they are not always easily adopted. So we think that this peer-to-peer strategy that we have could be part of the solution as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Christian. Yeah, for those that don't know CREA, they have a really fantastic model, and they're not only in Argentina, but they're also expanding into other regions in Bolivia, Paraguay, Uruguay, all over the region. And yeah, that's a real good model on the peer-to-peer, as you said, and it's very effective. So you mentioned also that I like that you're all talking about solutions on a solutions day for COP, but it's really the adoption of technologies that could be also the better adoption of technologies can also help to mitigate climate change. So that's something that we all need to invest and to work and to be creative. As you said, it's not one solution that fits all. So that's very important. So I'm going to just pass to our next panelist. So we have Nathalie Somerville. She's from Australia. She's also a farmer. So as you can see, we have a lot of farmers' voice today, and we are trying to bring more of the farmers' voice here into COP. So yeah, I would like just to pass to you, and you're also not only a beef, but also a sheep farmer. So please tell us your experience and also the role that cattle has to play, that grassland has to play in your farms.
Yeah, thank you so much. I was very excited to be asked to speak on a panel that's talking about grasslands, because it's not very often it's a focus. So yeah, thank you so much. So my name is Nat Somerville, and my background is Wagga Dagum, from the Mabiyag in the Torres Strait Islands. So that's where my cultural link comes from. I'm actually a farmer from South Australia and have been farming for almost 20 years in a grain and livestock production farming system. So very extreme differences in agricultural production, but I still carry that cultural lens with me in everything that I do. So I talk about agriculture in terms of our traditional agriculture that we have, that we've been doing for many thousands and thousands of years. And with that, the land management that comes along with it. And they go together, they're hand in hand, and they're very sustainable. Our more modern agricultural systems that we are managing today has more of that tension. And so that is something that I am always, negotiating with every farming decision that I make on our farm. So just to paint a picture of my particular location, I'm in South Australia, so 3 hours north of Adelaide, if anyone knows where that is, and predominantly grasslands-based country. And so we see a lot of kangaroo grass or themadar, and a lot of our smaller wallab sort of type, wallaby grass they call it. So lots of variation in grasses and herbs, which, as we know, is very important for animal nutrition. We have, as I mentioned, a mixed farming system. So we do the grain production alongside the livestock. So our grasslands, our native grassland country, is so critical to our farming business. We have many, many drought periods, and we rely on our grasslands to carry us through. That is our it's our guarantee that we are going to get through a drought is our grassland country. And that's why a lot of us in that area are mixed farmers. We are have that diversity. The other thing with grasslands that I want to talk about is the ability that it has to hold water, so the hydration factor, which often gets missed in these discussions. And so when we don't have hydrated landscapes, everything else around it fails. And that's really key for our really dry soils in Australia, especially where I am in South Australia. Is to maintain that hydration and so that the whole ecosystem functions and functions well. And most importantly, we need people to manage our grasslands, and we need skilled people to manage our sheep on those or livestock, cattle on our grasslands. And if we don't have all of those things working well together, we have a failed system, which we have seen in Australia previously when we had people taken off country, and a lot of our environment and agricultural areas were left unmanaged for many, many, many years. So we saw this really drying out of country because it wasn't grazed appropriately. So we know that with grasslands, in order to have healthy functioning grasslands, we need that continual management and the grass to be kept at a certain height in order to keep the grasses healthy. I suppose the other thing I wanted to point out is that we've got a lot of new innovations coming through to help us manage this better. So I've been, practicing rotational grazing on our grassland country for almost 20 years now, and it's showing the benefits, whereas my predecessors didn't quite use that rotational set stocking system. So we've seen just how much that has helped us. But the new innovations that's coming through today, with virtual fencing, and I don't know if any of you are using that now, but that's really exciting for us in Australia for that to happen and make it a lot easier in a lot of our bigger pastoral areas that are really hard to manage in country with really diverse landscapes and floodplains and the rest of it. My experience is not only working, as I mentioned, in southern Australia, but in northern Australia on big cattle stations, with lots of floodplains and waters, and we're faced with issues of crocodiles and other life-threatening things that go with it, which is quite a contrast to South Australia, where we might have a couple of snakes and that'll be it. But they're just some of the challenges that we face in Australia from one extreme to the other. We also hearing a lot about new technologies such as Asparagopsis, the red seaweed. And especially in Australia, in South Australia, it's being trialed at the moment. Very low scale, but at least it's getting there. We're seeing some research happen, but the key I feel is making it practical for our farmers. It's got to be easy for our farmers to use, and it also needs to be socially acceptable, because without having social license and a lot of our other things that we do in farming, it just will not get the traction we need. I might leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, Nat. You mentioned the rotational grazing, kind of the holistic management, and that's very important also for grasslands conservation and to do it properly, just to avoid the overgrazing. So I think that's also very important. And later, maybe we'll touch about data. I think all those practices, we need to start measuring which are the benefits for the grasslands, for the animals of doing this rotational grazing with the grasslands, and also to communicate that data. So thank you very much. Okay, so our last panelist is Thomas Westhoff. He's the president for the IIS World. He represents the youth voice. He represents the university students here at this panel that we also think it's very important to have. We have seen here at the COP a lot of representation from the youth, and it's very important. They're the next generation, and it's important also that they hear all the different panels, that they understand the different perspectives, and also that there is no one solution, not a one radical solution, but you all need to work together on different ones. So can you please tell us about your experience, what you have heard here at the COP, and your experience. You are also from the Wageningen University, so more the perspective from a student from Europe. So what's also on grasslands?
Yeah, thank you very much. And indeed, it was very inspiring panel so far. Very interesting to hear all the different systems. I'm from the Netherlands. We don't have crocodiles there, so I will tell about another perspective here. There are three points I want to highlight today. The first point is circular agriculture. The Netherlands is the second biggest food exporter after the United States. So we export a lot of food. We are also a big importer. And if I see one thing happening in the Dutch livestock system, which I want to warn other countries for, is depending heavily on imports. Because what we have seen is that the agricultural sector, and especially the livestock sector in the Netherlands, has grown a lot. A lot. We have now 2.57 million cows, 12 million pigs, 100 million chicken in a very small, densely populated country as the Netherlands. And that has created problems because it's seen as one of the places where a next pandemic can start. And at this year already, there have been a lot of problems with diseases, the flu, the chicken flu, and the gas has run out in the Netherlands. We cannot kill enough chickens anymore because there's strict regulations that chickens have to be killed when the flu, the bird flu, the chicken flu is detected. So we are constantly killing chickens to save other chickens in our country. So in that sense, I see a problem there with too much expansion of the livestock sector. Also, when you look at, for example, regulations, European regulations, but also national regulations, they're very strict on the amount of nitrogen we can emit. And currently in the Netherlands, you cannot build another house because when you're building another house, you're also emitting nitrogen, and the livestock sector is emitting that much nitrogen that we cannot build any new houses. So in that sense, a warning from the Netherlands, what I have seen in the development there, they are thinking of halving the total livestock amount of cows in the country. So a development to think about, to think more in a circular way. And in that sense, I heard some livestock systems here today that are circular. So I think that's good. But try to keep it that way. Also, land use choices are very important. And there have been a lot of historical mistakes being made in the past. For example, from moving from grasslands to forests, that has been a development around 300 years ago in the Netherlands, where we found mines and wanted to dig coal. So the idea was, let's grow more forests so we have woods to make a good foundation to explore our coal mines. But those forests still remain in areas that are not well chosen for it. And forests evaporate more water. So in that sense, there is less infiltration taking place in huge areas in the Netherlands, also threatening our water systems. So thinking about what is the hydrological situation of a certain area is very important. And we spoke a little about the aviation industry, about flying from Cairo to Sharm. I think one of the biggest sources from land use, which is double the amount of emissions from the aviation industry that I don't hear a lot of people talk about at this COP, are peatlands. Peatlands store twice as much carbon as all forests combined, but I don't see it anywhere on the agenda here. It's not seen, it's not taken into account that much. And in a country where I'm from, we have a lot of livestock production also happening on peatlands. I think that's very unsustainable and something we should reconsider and look at other forms of production on these agricultural lands. Then lastly, the last point, it was a busy night last night with the Coronavia discussions. I see some progress taking place there. I hope a conclusion will be found here at COP. Very important that we think about the future of this joint work on agriculture and have it a place at COP, because as we have seen with five pavilions around agriculture, it has a place here in these discussions because it can be an important player to solve the climate crisis. So in that sense, I think we should work more on that. Find it a pity to see there is no debate or no inclusion of a food systems approach. I think that's very important, because what we have seen with COVID is that it's a system. It's all interrelated. It's all linked. So in that sense, I think it's very valuable to also include consumers in the discussion. A discussion around diets was directly off the table. I understand it's a very tense topic for a lot of people, but I think it's something to think about, because as a farmer, you're ultimately also thinking about consumers, and there's often a lot of disparity and inequality in the food systems, with middlemen, supermarkets having a lot of say about prices. So in that sense, I find it a pity that that food system approach is off the table as it looks like now. So I urge anyone from the parties here involved in these discussions here to try to reconsider it. The G77 in China, I don't know where it struck. It's hard to see it from an observer point of view, but I hope a conclusion will be found here at COP. Thank you.
Thank you, Thomas. It was really interesting to see, like, also, as we said before, each country has to find its own solutions, and also bringing the perspective of a country like the Netherlands, where they're finding different solutions that they're finding in South Africa, Argentina, or Australia. And yeah, and it's also important to start sharing, to start seeing what solution goes best, and also to learn, as you said, from the past. So that's also very important, not to just go and think on one direction, but also trying to go back and see, okay, what worked and didn't work in the past, and learn from that. So before just opening the panel for questions from the public, I just want to just talking about again about solutions. What are you the rest thinking that, what are the solutions that you want to hear here at the COP and related to grasslands and to livestock management? What are your expectations on the challenges that you see for the future, on future COPs and the rest also for the livestock sector? So I'm going to start.
Farmers tend to learn more from other farmers than from anyone else. Farmers love to copy what works for other farmers. I think there's a lot of the solution in new technologies. And I'm not only referring to mechanical technologies, digital technologies, also biotechnologies. And I want to take an example of the cattle industry in the Netherlands. If the Netherlands is committed to cut the number of cattle by 50% in the next 8 years, we must actually rethink the language you use. If we say it is for the sake of climate, the climate covers us all. In this debate in Parliament, I remember, because the rest of the world's farmers followed this debate very nervously. In the debate, they referred to Africa, which would not necessarily need to follow suit. I remember one of the parliamentarians who said, there might be countries in Africa where we need more cattle, such as Ethiopia. Now, you know, from a farmer's perspective, the Dutch farmers are the kings of dairy. No one can compete with them on dairy cattle. The average Friesland Holstein gives you a yield of 32, 33 liters of milk per day. This is what they want to have. And then they say the Ethiopians can have more cattle, but there are already more cattle than people in Ethiopia. And the average yield of an Ethiopian cow is less than 1 liter of milk per day. That's what we can have more of. So if the need is to feed an extended family or a village with 100 liters of milk, you can service that with 3 Dutch cattle or 110 Ethiopian cattle. It simply does not make sense, because the climate covers us all. The real solution is we need more Dutch cattle in Ethiopia. It means Dutch investment in Ethiopia. It would not happen because Ethiopia is not that attractive an investment destination for the Dutch. So we are starting to implement from the wrong side. We must start with addressing the policy environment in Ethiopia and make it more conducive for profitable investments.
Thank you, Theo. I think I agree also with you, and I think it's important also to think on efficiency. The less efficient cattle, they also emit more methane, so it's also important that also to pass those technologies. If Ethiopia grows or other country grows in their herd, also to make sure that they're efficient to be more sustainable. So that's very important. I don't know if someone else wants to address the questions about.
Yeah, I can react on that. Yeah, I agree that indeed the technology in the Netherlands is there. I think, for example, in the horticulture sector, I see the same trend, because with raising energy prices, I see a lot of horticulture companies now trying to export their technologies, for example, to Morocco, where the climate is way more, way better to grow crops in horticulture production. But I think indeed it's a responsibility too, and of farmers there, but also of the sector behind it, to try to bring these technologies to other places. So now I agree with what Theo said.
Okay, thank you, Thomas. Any other comment?
Look, I just wanted to highlight, this is my first COP. And to get that understanding about one, well, I just want to say well done, Australia, for coming to the party, number one. But two, the lack of emphasis on farmers and farming systems and how we can be the solution to climate change. It's just not there. So for a first timer to a COP, how can we be more influential in this space? Because we need to have that input. A lot of our farmers manage land right across the world, and it is just ridiculous that we are not in the words in the important documents here at COP.
Yeah.
Thank you. Well, I think this is my third COP, and this is the first time that I see so much of food systems. I think in some way it's because of the summit in New York of the sustainable food systems, and something that in some moment we saw it as a kind of threat. At the end of the day, it was, in my point of view, a very positive aspect that we have ICA here. We are talking, there are a lot of farmers. I think in our narrative, the farmers, we must take a more proactive action. I mean, we are part of the solution, but we need more numbers to show that we can sequester more carbon. And I understand that we don't have many times, we don't have all these figures to show, but we have to go to the field and with the research institutions get these results, because we must be part of the solution. It cannot be, we cannot follow the example of the Netherlands, of any country. We can be inspired by other countries, by other situations, but we have to discover our own recipes, our own solutions. We have to work them out. I think we have a lot of work to do to show the community that we are part of the solution, and we have to show that with a lot of numbers. The data is extremely important. We as CREA, we are very concerned getting data from reality. So now for instance, the farmers, that they can learn very much from each other in order to improve their economic results. Now in our organization, they can compare in terms of environmental impact that they are having, so they can see who is having more with less impact. And this improvement, we have to aggregate that at national level and show, look, there are ways to improve the situation. Because the climate change is a reality, and we must be part of the solution. It's not without the people, it's not without the farmers that we will solve this crisis. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think we've heard the story from 12 cops now, where first there were two producers, and now I think you said there are over 150. But when we think about this COP where there's 40,000 people, I think 150 is like a pretty small portion of that 40,000. And so I think it's really important, these sort of dialogues from ICA, where we are seeing realities on the ground from the Netherlands and Australia, Argentina, South Africa. And we need to have more of those, which is why the Global Roundtable for Sustainable Beef is a great place to have those discussions, because I do believe that we can learn from one another. I mean, I've seen it myself in Paraguay with the Australian tanks of water systems. But I also believe that the local experts and the producers on the ground are really the ones who hold solutions in their local context. And so I think I would challenge all of us in the room to help push producers and support producers to be at the forefront of this discussion, because we know that sustainable livestock can be the solution to climate change. And so how can I, as civil society, how can all of us, maybe as financial institutions or retailers or brands, help bring more producers to these conversations, as they're the ones who have the solutions?
Thank you, Hillary. Just have one more question and then I just will open the floor. Just about, you mentioned, Christian, about data, and I think it's very important that we talk about that, because as you said, we need to be more proactive. We need to communicate about the benefits of being, how can livestock sustainably produced can be also a solution for climate change. So what do you think are the challenges? Why we don't yet have enough data? Why farmers, what's your opinion? Do they usually collect data in their normal basis, or is it like something new that they have to incorporate? And does it cost a lot of money when we talk about grasslands that we need to do, like soil analysis we need to do? So what does it take? Training? What are the things that can help us? We, as the Global Roundtable, we have like a climate goal to reduce 30% the footprint on carbon. So yeah, and we also have the same challenge. How are we going to collect data from the 24 countries where we have influence, from our 12 national roundtables where we work? So yeah, what do you think should be the next steps on having better data and also using that correctly, how to communicate that in the proper way?
Data is the new gold in agriculture. If we want to produce more on less and with less, we can only do it in one way, and that's through data-driven agriculture. Data is the precision part of precision agriculture. I once met Bill Gates about 4 or 5 years ago, and I must confess that 90% of what he said that day went way over my head. I'm on the wrong side of 55 to understand data. But basically, it boiled down to the fact that everybody in the food system needs data today. So we are part of a massive gold rush. And he said, you farmers should not take part in that gold rush. You must open the shops selling the spades to those who want to dig for the gold. Because no one can go from farm gate to collect the data. But the farmers' organization can be one big gate through which you can go to get to the data. So step one in aggregating data with integrity, to have density, is through farmers' organizations. But then our farmers need to be organized well. The harvesting of the data, the processing of it, the packaging of it, the selling of the data, can be the new glue to keep farmers together. In what kind of farmers' organization, whether it is general affairs organizations or cooperatives or whatever. The most important is that we must keep the ownership of our own data, or else we might not be in a position to buy back our own data again if it slips out of our hands.
I think I heard last year that data was the most important commodity now, that it's the most valuable. I think this highlights again the importance and the relevance of learning spaces so that producers can talk to producers about, this is how I'm measuring what's happening in my field. This was my suggestion. This was my path forward. And this is what I've learned from it, which really helps at a local level have those learnings pass through producers and have more rich data. I also think that the strength of learning spaces such as the GRSB is producers can identify what they need. So if they are missing certain technologies, if they're missing support from academia, they can kind of push that forward and say, I need some more support here. And that is the beauty of a collaborative space, I believe. We also know that there is some data that is already being collected, not just at a local level, but at a government level. So for instance, in Paraguay, with our collaboration in Paraguay with the government, they do have a number of data sources that already exist, but these data sources aren't necessarily integrated. And so that is a role, again, for collaboration. Who can come to the table to help integrate those data sources together so that everyone can make better decisions? Because we need that if we're going to be paying attention to our commitments and actually implementing our commitments, I think to your point earlier, Christian. And when we're talking about our indices and what everyone is talking about for the last 2 weeks here at the COP, we need data. And I think the answer to that data is collaboration and to continue to put forward, this is what I need in order to succeed.
Yeah, data is, without any doubt, as you mentioned, is the best way to learn from each other. I mean, from peer to peer, is showing data, showing information, and see how he's doing better than me, and then I can copy some of the practices, but also to communicate. Without any doubt, in the livestock, in the beef sector, it's extremely difficult to get all this data. We have, in our organization in Korea, we have also crop producers, and we have some decades of crops data and millions of hectares following the same plot. What was the yield? Which were the practices that were performed in this plot, and follow this by 20 years, and we can learn, we can collaborate with the academia, with research, and we realize that it is possible to learn a lot from all this data. We are working also with big companies from abroad, from the Silicon Valley or from Seattle, working how we can extract more juice to this all this data. And it's amazing what we are learning. But I mean, in the crop production, it's much easier. I mean, you have a lot of machine, the combiners. I mean, you are collecting data a lot. But now there are a lot of sensors which are collecting data also in the livestock sector, in the beef sector. The weighings, we can follow the weights pretty easy. And we are learning a lot. I think there is a promise that we are going to be able to learn much more how to be more efficient with all the data because of the reducing cost of the sensors. Nevertheless, I think carbon is a huge challenge because so far carbon, you have to go there and sample the soils, and it costs a lot of money. And it costs a lot of money. We have been going around and say, "Oh, there are some promising sensors to check the carbon in the soil," but we don't have it yet. So I think this is the next step to find which could be the way to reduce the price of carbon sampling. It's extremely important. Otherwise, we are not going to be able to follow.
Thank you, Christian.
Yeah, I wanted to pick up that point on carbon measurement, especially in a little bit, but I just wanted to mention that in Australia, we have farmer producer groups called the farming systems groups, where we come together and we learn from each other about best practice or not. You know, we learn both the good and the bad, And it works well, and especially in South Australia, we have a lot of groups right around, very specific to location and farming system. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the keys. So if we can keep investing in that type of learning, that is absolutely critical. Data is only as good as the accuracy that it is collected with. And that is the case with carbon measurements in soil, because there's a debate going on about the accuracy of carbon, depending on the person who's doing it, and their level of integrity of doing that. So this is a conversation we're having in Australia at the moment about the measurements of carbon and making sure that it is, robust, so that we can be sure that when we are, you know, saying to the world that we are reducing our carbon emissions by this and this, that it is all very, evident that we know what we're talking about, and it is very precise.
Thank you. I think it's very important also to start collecting for carbon also. We need sometimes 10 years of data. So really we need to start as soon as possible, because also, especially on grasslands that we talk about, if the carbon gets released or not during a certain period of years. So yeah, it's an urgent thing, a call to action.
Yeah, speaking about data and COP, I think something fundamental is missing currently, that is having accurate national inventory reporting. All the countries are reporting, but often the accuracy is horrible. If I look at my country, I think they are doing a very bad job. Well, they say it's a tier 2, tier 3 analysis, and I think, okay, that you are even calling it that way. So I think all looking critically to our national inventory reporting will also help everyone in society just having a better grip, and also helps these discussions, because we know then where the gaps are. But I understand the complexity about it, that countries don't want to report more emissions than they do, because that's often the case. They're under-reporting, of course. But I think what can help there, the solution is in the skies, satellites. I'm currently working on using satellite imagery in seeing subsidence of peatlands and having better estimations of the carbon emissions from that. I see similar projects ongoing. The ESA has a big project on seeing where greenhouse gases are. I think that can help. I see a lot of potential in that, in our new developments. But I would say it's a very good development, and better to invest in that than sending someone to Mars or to the moon. I think it's better to look at the Earth and improve our reporting there.
Thank you, Thomas. Yes, consistency of data is also very important. Also, how do you compare one data with the other from different countries? So that's also a challenge. And of course, technologies and cost. So I would like to open the floor. We have 12 more minutes. So I would like to open the floor for questions. So.
Thank you so much for the wonderful discussion. I'm from Japan. And Japan is not a big producing country, but big consuming country of the agriculture products, including beef, by the way. So when I see the carbon footprint of my own country, it's not really coming from the domestic production side, but more like the importation side of the food. We import 60% plus of the calorie from abroad. And if we track that, we can clearly see where, from whom, or what we created. We cause a lot of environmental footprint. By the way, it's not only carbon, it's biodiversity, it's soil, it's water, and even fertilizer. So my question for you is that if we put a kind of dig the data and put the consumption side, consuming countries' role in it, is this helpful or not helpful? Let me say this way. If Japanese consumer can see the impacts of importing the beef from Argentina, for instance, and see how much it does harm, or maybe it does actually good through that production, do you think does it help you moving more forward for more sustainable beef production or not. So it's more like a role of the consuming country. And does it help you moving sustainable beef production or not? So that's a question.
I take that, and I think one important thing is all the negotiations that are happening here in some way, and you mentioned something when they say the inventories, maybe they don't want to improve it much better because otherwise they will show that the crisis in the climate is going to be regardless the quality of the inventories. So something that I'm very concerned on is that many of the negotiations are mixing trade with environment. And this, I think this is extremely dangerous because they are in some way seeing that some trade barriers can't come because of environment. And I think it's, we must separate completely trade from environment. Saying that, I think it's extremely important, the transparency in the supply chains, in order to drive the farmers, to drive the whole supply chain, to promote those systems which are better with environment, better with all the attributes that you were mentioning, and in some way to give the incentives to those who are doing the right things, and also the incentives to improve to those farmers which are a bit late on adopting. I think it's the transparency of the information through the supply chain is, in my point of view, extremely important to be part of the solution.
The restrictions that it's more like how to value. And then those farmers who are really safeguarding natural capital, how the consumer can pay for that. That's what I
hear.
Yes, if I also can take a bite at this apple. You want to change the food systems? You change consumer behavior. Farmers will always produce what consumers will buy from them. That's why we talk of value chains in agriculture. You cannot push a chain. You can only pull it. And the consumer is the only pulling force. No use we try to produce something or produce it in a way which the consumers would not want. But then, last week, in one of the very first side events I attended, a legendary scientist in this space, Bruce Campbell, who used to be with CCUFS and CGIR, but he's now with Climate. He quoted research they did exactly 10 years ago in 2012 on the lamb value chain in London. And they found that the lamb they imported from Australia had less than half the carbon footprint of the UK-produced lamb in London. Because the UK-produced lamb was fed in feedlots with soya that came from Brazil, maize that came from South Africa, and then mixed and processed in a factory which usually mostly use heat. So if you combine the total value chain, it was actually a friendlier option to transport it all the way from Australia than to produce it locally.
I will take one.
Josefina, okay. Do you mind? I just want to say, I feel like we planted you in the audience to ask this question. So thank you. I believe that the pending legislation that we're currently seeing from the European Union, the United States, the Forest Act, as well as the United Kingdom, is showing a very clear market signal to more sustainable management practices. And while countries have their own national agendas, which are extremely important, I do think we are seeing a shift. I mean, I think that we can see that there are a number of food systems pavilions here because of that shift. And so I think a follow-up question is not only what makes sense in terms of pending legislation, what's a feasible ask, but also what can an importer country do to help support. So for instance, in the forest sector right now in the United States, there is financial and technical assistance that is going to be provided, if it goes through, to countries that have increased forest governance. So that's a way of the United States saying, not only we think forests are important, not only we respect national agendas because it's about illegal deforestation only, but also saying we are here to support. We're here to support. We're going to put our money down and we're going to help in terms of technical assistance as well. So I think it's a great signal forward. Thank you for the question.
Thank you.
Well, thank you everyone for such a great panel. It's great to have farmers here again at the Home of Agriculture of the Americas. Dr. Ishii, we're honored by your presence here and your questions. Arigato. Thinking about the future, the next COP, and thank you, Rory, for this great panel from GRSB, Josefina. What should we do next? We talked about data, we talked about carbon. What should be some of the key points of emphasis for ICA to come back next year, hopefully with more ministers, more farmers, more specialists that can help us figure out how farmers can help be that part of the solution? What do you all recommend as the key elements that we should emphasize or that we missed?
Just one thing is, I think there are many examples of good practices in the whole Americas. I believe that to emphasize these good examples that we are seeing in our countries could be something very interesting to put on the next COP, because we are talking that this COP is of implementation, so we can see some more good examples next year.
Yeah, I think loss and damage will be a prime point on the agenda, as it's already this COP, but next COP. And I think it's the responsibility of the global north to look more to the global south. And as we have seen during CFS 50 in Rome, which I also attended, there was for the first time no conclusion. The war in Ukraine led to big problems across the globe in food security. So I think food security should be on the agenda. And then also looking at the resilience adaptation of communities in the global south hit hardest by the effects of climate change. I think that should be on the agenda for sure.
I'd like to see more mixtures of ministers sitting next to producers, because the ministers are the ones that are making the policy and the producers are the ones who are doing it on the ground.
Thanks, Josefina, and thanks everybody for coming today. Thank you particularly for IICA for the space here. I think it's been a really good discussion and a tremendous panel of people who've got real live experience of producing food. And remember, that's what this is all about. It's about producing food that feeds now 8 billion people on the planet. I think it was Teo who mentioned the need for investment. I would really like to underline that. The only thing that we actually all need is food and water, right? Shelter. Of official development of assistance, only 5% goes to agriculture. That is absolutely not enough to solve the global scale of the problem that we have. Food systems need more investment. Of the 5% that goes to agriculture, 1/25th, in other words, 0.2 of 1%, goes to livestock development. That is to an activity, in other words, that covers 2/3 of the food producing land in the world. If you think you can make a difference to 2/3 of the food producing land in the world with 0.2% of investment, you are sadly mistaken. We need to invest more. We heard a lot today about the things that we could do. Why are we not doing them? Because we don't have the investment. We need to invest more. So thank you all very, very much for coming to this. side event. It's been a pleasure to for GRSB to be able to call together this group of people. It's been a real pleasure being engaged actually throughout the week with EECA. So thank you again.
We're going to start getting ready for us.